Online Broadcast Network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads from over 200 countries and your number one source in after-show entertainment. AfterBuzz TV, the destination for TV superfans. Producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows. Interviewing celebrities and showrunners. And bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hey guys, welcome to AfterBuzz TV. I am so excited to be here hosting the recap and review show for classic Doctor Who episodes. I'm your host, Zach Wilson, wearing my trusty fez.
Please keep it.
Every week we expect
until
you to be
it
in
falls
that.
Off mm-hmm. of my head. It is precariously balanced right now. But enough about my fez. I'd like to introduce my fantastic panel for this week's episode, An Unearthly Child, Season 1, Episode 1. Starting at the other end of the table, we've got the lovely Megan Salinas.
Hi, Whovians.
We have the wonderful Tauri Miller. See, it fell off my head.
Pick it up.
And right next to me, Katie Cullen.
Hi, all my buddies.
She doesn't even need a qualifier. I was distracted by the fact.
I qualify myself.
So let's talk a little bit about what exactly we're going to be doing here, because this is the first one. We did some classic Who at AfterBuzz last year in between episodes of Season 7, but what I wanted to do for this panel is really get a walkthrough of the classic Who for people like me who admittedly has never delved into the classic Who. I'm a massive Doctor Who fan, but I started with the 2005 series, and I just watched right through. I didn't know where to begin going back to classics.
To be fair,
that's where we all stand. Yeah. We're all just like, classic Who, there's 60 years of it. That's great.
Yeah, to be fair, that's a lot of canon to go through if you're a newbie.
So it's
for new people, even starting off at 2005, for newer people, it's like, that's still like, what are we in? Season eight now?
Yeah.
That's still eight seasons
God
to go through.
God help you to go back to 1963 and know where to begin. Yeah.
And you can't even be a completionist for the episodes starting from then because we've lost episodes, especially from the second Doctor season. They were destroyed in a fire. They were recorded over. They no longer exist. So you literally cannot be a completionist for this series. It's physically impossible.
Except when we find them in a vault in Zimbabwe occasionally.
Right.
But they're in there are screen caps and plot summaries, but there's not actual footage.
Someone's basement.
Are they in like where the Ark of the Covenant is at? They're just in a box down there?
The only complete collection of Doctor Who is with the Ark of the Covenant. It's with Noah's Ark.
The Crystal Skull.
But so what we're gonna do is we're gonna pick random, like a few, not completely random episodes, but a lot of the big ones, the fun episodes, and so that you guys can watch along with us and really just take this journey so that you have some people to watch with. Because that's really, I just didn't know where to begin. So now you know. Now you can join us.
So here's a question. Are we going to take fan recommendations for what we should and should not watch?
Absolutely. Tweet at us at episodes that you want to see. Stuff, if you have opinions about, like, you can't not do this episode, you have to do this, or it's like, how did you skip that one if we accidentally skipped one? Tweet at us. We will mainly, all right, this is going to fall. But
give
I'll
it
put
to
it
me.
Up.
Give
right
it to
there.
Me. Tauri.
Yeah.
But so, guys, we're only going to be doing episodes that are available on Netflix or Hulu Plus. That way you can watch with us. Those are both places that a lot of people have access to. Mm-hmm. So that's what we're going to stay focused on.
Also, tell us what to avoid, because my understanding is that there are some episodes there that MST3K really should have gotten their hands on.
They can't all be winners.
No, no, not even in the new series.
Yeah, seriously.
I could think of no better place to start than the very first Doctor Who story ever with An Unearthly Child.
Yeah.
So it's a four-part series because back in the day, it was broken up into 24-minute episodes that would air. This particular episode aired in it got a weird kick to start. It was the day after JFK was assassinated.
Yeah. Have you ever seen An Adventure in Space and Time that they did last year?
It's a fascinating. If you haven't seen An Adventure in Space and Time, it's based on a true story biopic about the about like, the making of what we're talking about today.
Yeah, exactly.
It's fascinating.
Yeah, it's kind of weird having seen that, but then not having seen the first episode of Doctor Who, so it was actually nice to sit down and see. It's like, oh, okay, this is what they're referencing.
But so it opens up on this, the classic, like, what it became very classic shot, the policeman just, like, walking by with the music that we know so well, just carrying into the show, and then it lands on the TARDIS. Sitting there in a junkyard.
Yeah, and for all the audience knows, it's just a police box. I mean, what's the significance of this?
Right.
We've never seen this show before. It's brand new.
But and as longtime fans, it's like, oh, okay, it's very fitting that, you know, the show opens up on the TARDIS.
Yeah, because it's not, like, that is the only constant throughout all of Doctor Who is the TARDIS, the police box. The Doctor changes. The Doctor, in you could even argue, is not the main character of Doctor Who. But the TARDIS is always there, except when she flies away for plot purposes.
For whatever reason.
But she always
peace,
comes back.
I'm out.
Yeah. She's a stray dog.
And I thought it was very interesting, because we're meeting the teachers. We meet these two teachers. That's it. We get to meet companions before anybody else, before we even know who the Doctor is. So we get to meet Ian Chesterton and Barbara Wright.
In case you were wondering whether this was a British show.
Chesterton may have been a giveaway.
Ian Chesterton.
Of Essex is having a lovely tea, spot of tea at the end of the day. I'm not going to try to do a British accent on this show.
Please it's don't. Please don't.
You just worry everyone.
Met.
They're talking about Susan Foreman. Is her name. She's too smart. Suspiciously smart.
Wait, which it's interesting because I knew that the Doctor traveled around with his granddaughter to start, but I never thought that they tried to go undercover because, you know, that they would stay in one place because we're so accustomed to the Doctor always going from one place to the next. You know, he's always running. It's kind of weird to think that there was a period in time where he didn't. He just sat and waited for a while.
Yeah, that was something I had no idea that this was a plot line. As they follow her home because these are very concerned teachers who...
Was that a thing back then? Because
the
60s, that was unsettling.
That was a little odd.
I guess there's not a way to follow up except to just walk behind someone in those days.
Well, but they made a really good point that for all intents and purposes, Susan has a high intelligence score and a low wisdom score. She knows all these physics problems. She's working things into the fifth dimension, but she doesn't know how British currency works.
Although, that's a really fascinating thing to look back on. Today, because today the British currency does run on a decimal system.
Right.
And she was ahead of her time.
What? Well, didn't she make a comment about, oh, you don't have it yet, or something like that?
But that's the writers could have no way of knowing. And so it's actually like this really creepy, like, oh, maybe they did have a time machine.
They weren't on the decimal system?
It's like looking back at old books that predicted like dystopian futures and seeing some different things that were predicted and going, that is oddly similar to what they talked about.
H.G. Wells was pretty good at it.
Yeah, I mean, you get a lot of that in science fiction because that's what their job is. Their job is to predict the future in a way. And sometimes you go into fantastic views, as we do often on Doctor Who, but occasionally you're just going to get a nugget of truth. Like, we may not have flying cars, but money is not broken up into sixteenths anymore. I think anyone could have predicted that. I can't imagine.
I can't imagine.
I just count it. Okay, and then carry the two.
It's like galleons and sickles and nuts.
I didn't want to say it because I felt like that would be really culturally biased. But yes.
Oh, no, it's galleons and sickles and nuts. Let's be real.
But so anyway, they follow her home to a junkyard. At 76 Tauri Lane.
In the middle of the night.
Yeah, in the middle of the night, which...
Again, not at all creepy.
No, they're just concerned.
But it felt like that's such a... But her line, I loved her line. It was such an alien thing to say. I like walking through the dark. It's mysterious. And it's like just hinting at like that this character... There's a lot more going on with this character.
Yeah, but for anybody who doesn't know, it's like, what is up with this girl? Because she, obviously, like you said, she's really smart, but also strangely naive. Like, who's going to walk around in the middle of the night when it's really foggy and clearly dangerous?
Well, and look at it from the point of view, these viewers are watching this for the first time. They haven't even met the Doctor yet. They don't know anything about the Time Lords or the TARDIS or any of the lore that this particular panel, at least, has come equipped with. They're watching this going, why does she know about five dimensions and not have any idea how currency works? And why does she live in a junkyard? Why doesn't her grandfather receive visitors? This is really odd. So if you kind of step back and look at it as you assumedly would from 1963, you can go, okay, yeah, this is building suspense for that crowd.
Yeah. It's like the same level of intrigue that you have when you're watching something like Lost, where it's like, oh, polar bears. I hope they explore this.
Yeah, but Doctor that Who hurts. Follows up, or at least it did until recently.
The other thing for modern fans who may not have noticed it, this is at the school that they're at is the Coal Hill School, which is where current companions Clara and we're getting to know Danny.
That's where they
work.
Teach.
That's where they teach.
Right.
Oh, that's hilarious.
A lot of people didn't pick up on it if you weren't familiar with it. So like I missed it the first time through. But yeah, they're back at the school where it all started.
That actually is very clever. Well done, current writers and producers and everything like that.
And so I'm also watching now, like, I wonder if this is gonna come into play at all.
Start seeing more parallels with this currency.
If it's just like a nice little wink at fans, or if it's like this is going to be important.
Right. Either way, I'm satisfied because I don't mind the winks. I actually like the winks and the nods, but if it turns out to be something important and relevant to the plot, that'd be awesome.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, the first big drop was in, I believe it was the 50th, when they just like show Clara at this school and they show the I Am Foreman thing that we see in this episode, and it's just a big like, hey guys, we remember that this is a 50-year-old show. But so they finally follow her home and they're walking through and they're like, where did she go? She disappears in this junkyard. And then we finally meet the Doctor.
He just seems to be like this old crazy person.
I just adore the sheer number of cares that the Doctor does not give. And those of you who know me that was a wonderful self-censor.
Thank you for keeping it PG.
Yeah. This is the last show that needs to be rated explicit on iTunes, all right?
So, but I'm curious, what did you guys think of this first scene with the Doctor? I was actually surprised how much you could see of the character that we've come to know and love in this old version. Like, so many people have been like, oh, he's totally different. He's like an asshole Doctor when he starts out. I could feel that like colorful, like light warmth as much as he's like toying with and playing with these people in that
you
first scene.
You kids get off my lawn.
Yeah,
he's right. Like one of those really old cats, and we have this at the shelter that I volunteer at, where he doesn't like anyone, and he doesn't want you to come in, and he doesn't want to look at you, and he doesn't want to play, but you know, if you manage to scratch under his chin for a little bit, he'll go, fine. I tolerate you. Your lap is warm. It's mine now. He's that kind of cat.
So, yeah, back when the Doctor tolerated companions as opposed to, hey, you want to go on an adventure?
Well, except for his granddaughter. He obviously loves her.
Well, he cares for his granddaughter. And he's like, why are you people here? They're like, are you her grandfather? Oh, well, I don't like to discuss my personal matters with strangers. But he has that like sort of levity while he's threatening them. He's like, you should get, I dare you to call the police. I double dare you.
I double dog dare you.
Oh, he's getting serious now. No, you're absolutely right. Because to me, it actually did seem like if the Doctor, the current Doctor that we know, was an old man. And granted, yes, Capaldi is a little older than, say, Tennant or Matt Smith. But yeah, it's kind of like it's the same guy who's gone on all these adventures and who's done all these amazing things, who has that twinkle in his eye. But at the same time, he's not going to put up with any nonsense.
Right.
And this is before the Time War pretty much tore him to pieces.
Yeah, exactly.
So that is also something to keep in mind. Yeah, he doesn't have the soul-killing black hole angst in there. So that's also something to keep in mind.
Oh, yeah. I feel like I didn't warn anybody listening. By the way, spoiler alerts. We are going to be talking, we are going to be keeping all of Who in, this is not a spoiler-free zone.
Yeah.
Everything up to what has aired is fair game.
It's impossible for us as people who are approaching classic Who for the first time to leave all of our current baggage behind. Yeah. In terms
I wonder
of being
how
fans.
This will play out later on.
Right.
So that just a general warning. We're going to be talking about everything up until last week's episode, and same thing going forward. When they finally start to go towards the TARDIS because Susan's yelling,
oh, grandfather, is that you?
She opens the door. It's like, right. Congratulations.
And then you finally see a panic. Like, he's done, like, the game's over. Like, he's not going to play with them anymore. Like,
the jig is up, yeah.
Yeah, they know she's in there, and now they think that he's kidnapped his granddaughter.
To them, the TARDIS is this little tiny police box that he has locked this young girl in.
The TARDIS is about...
For some reason.
It's about this half of the table right here.
And they did make sure that he had already done a loop around the TARDIS before that. And so they finally get inside, and we get this crazy starch white set from the 60s, the original interior of the TARDIS.
And it's bigger on the inside.
And you can tell it's from the 60s.
Oh, yeah.
That aesthetic.
Plenty of round things.
Yes.
And the TARDIS console looks so small.
Yeah.
It doesn't go all the way up to the ceiling.
It's very staunch. I actually like that it doesn't go all the
Me
way up
too.
To the ceiling. I thought that was, it made it more compact, like it actually was a...
Like a console.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, if you're in an airplane, like, yeah, you have switches up here, but you don't have, like, this random...
I like the ceiling bits.
I guess it, like, gives, you imagine that it runs all the way through.
Mm-hmm.
It changed. I don't like it.
It's different than what I like. Man, no.
My life is changing and I don't like it.
But then they're confronted. This is the first time that Ian and Barbara are confronted with the concept that there's more to the universe than they know.
Because
the first time the audience hits it, too.
And they still reject it. They're like, this is an illusion. And they're even telling Susan, like, look, this guy is tricking you. This is all an illusion. None of this is real. Like, they're in that far of denial.
It's like, no, you people are nuts. This is all real. It's time and relative dimensions in space. Like,
Susan came up with the name.
I had no idea when she said that she came up with the name TARDIS. I just sat there and I was like, oh my gosh, and he still calls it the TARDIS after all this time.
Well, here's my question about that. Has that been sort of retconned out? Because Time Lords that we meet all over various points of modern Who, like the Master and everyone else, refer to it as a TARDIS.
Who said that she came up with it after they left Gallifrey?
It's true.
It may be one of those things where she said it once and everyone went, oh,
it just like,
I like that.
Everyone on Gallifrey is calling it a TARDIS.
Yeah, right. It's that slang that catches on because otherwise you have that really big mouthful of a name and no one wants to say the whole thing. So hey, there you go.
That's
Susan
true.
Started
and
a
we
trend.
don't know how old she is in terms of like Time Lord years.
It's true.
Well, and everything like that.
I mean, if the Doctor is on his first, he hasn't regenerated yet.
Yeah, we don't know how old they are. Is she really supposed to be 18 and is just an 18-year-old Time Lord?
I think so. I mean, that's what I take. I saw some, like, insane theories that are based in, like, further stuff in Doctor Who where she's, like, not his granddaughter and just calls him grandfather. I don't know the basis of that.
I don't like that either.
Yeah.
No.
There's some insanity theory. I mean, it's Doctor Who. Come on. These are
that's
the best.
True.
These are the best
plot
and worst
is very
fans.
Very wibbly wobbly, timey wimey.
Reject your theory and substitute canon. And I don't ever do that.
Go ahead, Tom.
I had read somewhere that she was only his granddaughter because the writer didn't want there to be like a sexual implication to this young girl riding around with this old guy. So he's like, nope, they're related, and we're done.
Boy, has the show ever changed.
Hasn't it?
Yeah, they don't really shy away from... odd sexual tension anymore. But then again, it's 2014 and not 1963.
That's right. True,
yeah.
Too.
The
times they are a-changing.
But I thought that was fascinating. And then they sort of get launched into time.
into time and space.
That's true. Because they're not, they couldn't be in London, where after the teleport goes and they get dropped into prehistoric times.
Which really just looks a lot like my hometown, I'll be honest.
It looks like the middle of the desert. It's like, all right, this is a...
cow skulls scenic. And all.
then we get into... So that's like the cliffhanger.
It's which, a caveman like, staring at the TARDIS like...
Which, for that first episode, I thought it was fantastic.
Yeah. I really liked that first part. I can't say that I'm as fond of the rest of the saga, so to speak, but it is a wonderful introduction to all these different characters and to the TARDIS itself and to the idea of time travel and to the idea of aliens and everything like that. It's really interesting.
It was just enough to lay down the premise for a brand new audience, get them on board, and then that very last shot leaves them wondering, oh no, prehistoric times, whatever will they do next?
Yeah, I mean, obviously the camera, the graphics, the sound, it all doesn't quite hold up in terms of like a timeless episode, but in terms of content, it totally does. It's still intriguing, it's still fun, the characters are there, it's good writing.
And it's kind of funny, you know, just kind of for like filmmaking 101, it's just kind of funny to watch it go out of like the frame, go like out of focus for like a second or two every now and then as it's like moving from person to person.
Because they had like very deep lenses that they had to rack, like when they focus.
Before the days of automatic focus.
Yeah, exactly.
When they have to swing the shot, you can kind of see it moving. It's like, yeah, someone's walking with a camera there.
And so guys, before we jump into episodes 2, 3, and 4 of An Unearthly Child, I want to just take a brief moment and talk about our own little magical teleportation device called iTunes. Is that a bit of a stretch?
Yes. A little bit.
But it does transport us into your homes, much like how the Doctor describes the TARDIS as
less
just bigger on the inside because it's like a TV, how there's a whole world inside your TV. There's a whole world inside your YouTube and your iTunes, and we're part of that world.
Your metaphor has died.
If you're talking about the world inside the computer, that's called the grid. So we're talking about something completely different.
Yes, that's a different
but so, but so I hope you guys are enjoying the podcast. We do this for you, the fans. This is a podcast. We have a blast doing it, but really it's for you to enjoy, for you to experience, and we want to make it the best experience that it can be. And the only way that we can do that is for you to tell us how we are doing. Tell us if we're doing good. I hope you can go onto iTunes and slap us with a 5-star rating. It makes our day. Hit us with a review. You can go onto YouTube and talk about your thoughts on the episode in the comments. Like, let us know, as we said before, what episodes you want to see us do on Classic Who, and what episodes you want to see us not do. What should we totally just avoid and run away from?
Or what should we make fun of?
Yeah. We could also do that. We could just do a Mystery Science Theater 3000 style thing.
I'm down for that.
But so another way that you guys can help us out is... This is a big help for us. It takes just 30 seconds of your time to go onto Podcast One and do a survey for us. It's a big deal. We love hearing from you. Keep sending us tweets and all that. We read every one of them. But we need to get more direct answers to who you are, how you're listening, and that's what this survey is about. So if you go onto podcastone.com, your responses, just take a quick couple minutes, fill out the survey. Your responses are going to help us make this network better, make it better for you, to help to know how you listen to the show, how you engage with it. All of that is very important to us. So do it now. Take just a couple minutes of your time. Take the survey at podcastone.com. Once again, podcastone.com.
podcastone.com. Spell it out.
Yes. Oh, yes. The whole the whole letters.
Yeah. O-N-E. We're not
using
one,
any numbers.
O-N-E.
No numbers or symbols here.
Except for the dot.
All right. Yes.
I'm going to make your life difficult tonight.
Apparently so. So let's get into episode 2, The Cave of Skulls.
Yeah.
Was that a good sigh or a bad sigh?
You know, when we came into Classic Who, the first episode was what we were expecting. We were not expecting the other three episodes to be caveman politics. Which, that was a surprise.
I will say these are the most well-spoken cavemen that I've ever seen outside of, like, cartoons.
Right.
And the, but it was, and that's what made it really frustrating, because they were pretty well spoken, but they couldn't figure out fire. He's like, if I rub my hands together enough, it'll work. But then they have this whole political system. And the other thing that really bothered me is that they would flip-flop so quickly, like at the
drop of a hat. It's like an alpha dog system. It's like, all right, you seem like strongest. We follow you. Oh, you seem stronger? All right, cool. We're going to follow you now.
Well, this is like the early, early days of humanity where they barely learned to use tools. Fire is just this new thing. It's new technology. It's like your grandma asking for help with the internet. It's like, this thing is cool. It's good. I don't understand it. Please help.
The thing is, the old lady knew how to make fire. And the other guy who knew how to make fire and how to make it is dead now.
Well,
so
the old woman
this technology.
Fears fire. It's the older generation fearing new technology.
It made me wonder if the previous guy who knew how to use fire who died, did he die in a fire?
I feel that's what I was thinking. I think the old woman watched, like, her son burn to death and was like, fire bad.
Yeah.
No fire.
It's like, yeah, we're done with this.
I actually thought, I was surprised how deep this episode got. I mean, yes, it's like, it's the 60s and there's silliness of, like, how realistic these cavemen are. They're speaking English. We haven't yet gotten into the TARDIS translation matrix and all that.
body language.
Anyway,
like, what just happened?
So anyway, they go out, like, the what I thought was very interesting is we get a little bit more of, like, how the TARDIS works. They're explaining, he's like, because Ian and Barbara are like, this is insanity. Prove it. Prove to us that this is real. And so he's like, okay, opens the doors.
And they walk on out, and they're like, oh, how about that?
This is not the junkyard.
And
it's also not an improvement.
And I like how Ian needed, like, help, because wasn't he near fainting at this point?
Well, they both fainted. Him and Barbara both just, like, went unconscious when they went through the time vortex. I guess it's like a shock, maybe?
I guess.
Right.
That they just went down. And the doctor gets kidnapped.
Yeah, I was definitely not anticipating the doctor getting kidnapped by a caveman in this episode. For some reason, that just never occurred to me.
Because it sounds like Mad Libs.
the thing is, like, they drop, and again, I didn't know this about the original stories, is that the doctor is not quite on the run, per se. He's lost and can't get back. He doesn't have complete control of the TARDIS. This isn't like the current run where the TARDIS will go random places because she decides he needs to. This is just like, no, it's broken. He, like, doesn't know what to do. It's just not working entirely. They're trying to get home. It's the voyages of the... That's my initial thought. But so he's just trying to get from... he has to go out and get a piece of local... I don't know, what did he have to get? Like, just anything?
I don't know, he just started smoking.
But, like, he had
a pipe, not, like, on fire.
It could be that he's like, I gotta go get this thing, I need a smoke. Dear God.
These people.
Humans, am I right?
Well, he's saying that he needs something of local, it's like something local to give the TARDIS so that they can pinpoint where they are.
Well,
because he doesn't know.
But another good thing to kind of point out is that when they step outside of it, he looks and it's still a police box. And he says, that's weird, because there's something that should make it blend into its environment.
The chameleon circuit.
Exactly. It must be on the front.
And he has no idea. I guess they hung out in the 60s for too long. Maybe that's part of it.
But I really did. That was another one of my favorite moments, is he's like, huh, that's kind of weird. It's still a police box. And I was just like, oh, that's why.
The symbol now famous throughout, like, the universe. Like, it's on stained glass and, like...
It's, like, you know, on hieroglyphics at the pyramids and everything.
That's a beautifully iconic screw up.
Well, and it makes me wonder, because I know that he's like attached to it. He gets attached to that sort of image at some point. So I have to wonder if like he was able to fix it and then be like, you know, I'll keep it. Or if he's just like, I like it. I'm not going to bother to fix it.
Well, it's like if you change the color of your house, you come back and you're like, my house used to be blue. Why is it white? Oh, I painted it last weekend. I still wish it were blue. It's changing what home looks like.
That's true.
Right.
Yeah. And then, like, they're getting out in the world. They're trying to figure out what to do. They're, like, going on a mission. Ian's trying to figure it out. I loved his line. Perhaps if we knew his name, we might have a clue to all this. Which, in context of Modern Who, where the name is, like, this massive plot point.
That's true.
Like, maybe we would. Maybe the whole of Doctor Who would just make a lot more sense if he'd say his name, Moffat.
I don't think so. I think he's just grasping at straws.
Right.
Plus, you know, the doctor's name is like Bob or something.
That's exactly what I was going to say. Doctor. It's going to be something really, really innocuous and just really kind of boring.
And the fandom will explode. All that history of his name was Bob?
But so anyway, talking about this episode, it took me a couple moments before I connected orb, like what orb was.
They kept
saying it so quick, and I was just like, they're like, orb will give us fire. And I was like, orb, oh, and then I felt really dumb for not getting immediately.
I literally did not make that connection until you said it right now. It's like, it's their ancient fire god, these cavemen.
Cal, this like rogue caveman who like was saved, I guess, by Za, the current leader of the tribe. Mm-hmm. Very simple names. Cal and Za.
Like Kal-El and Zod.
All we need is somebody named Own.
That's what I'm thinking. Like, oh, Cal and Zod sounds great right now.
What's pizza afterwards?
But so we get he's trying to say he brought this old man in strange furs, and he's saying, this man can make fire. I saw him make fire from his fingers. And not like this. It was more like this, like with a match, and then like he had smoke billowing from his mouth. The doctor smoked a pipe, which I kind of want the doctor to smoke a pipe again. That's just so classy.
Capaldi with a pipe.
Oh my god, it'd be so badass.
Would he be sitting next to a fireplace?
He's sitting in his little chair at the book, next to the shelves.
Yeah, that could work. Yeah.
He totally is. He needs a pipe in that chair. It would. Oh.
Only if they make the "ceci n'est pas un pipe" reference, the piece of art. It's like, of course it's a pipe. What are you talking about?
I don't know what you're referring to.
I don't know what that reference is either.
It's the painting of the pipe, and underneath it says, ceci n'est pas un pipe, which is French for, this is not a pipe, it's absurdist.
Oh, yeah.
I know you've seen this image.
So the cavemen.
Right, so the cavemen.
And so
Quit trying to teach us things, Katie.
Seriously.
Art history.
So the team goes on this like insane rescue mission, which there is not thought out. At all.
No, these are the most inept worst rescue ever.
Of all time.
They bust in, like, then we get into the third part, Forest of Fear, and they're basically stuck. Like, they've all now been kidnapped, thrown into the Cave of Skulls, which is really just the most basic name for a place ever. It's like, it's a cave, and we have lots of skulls in there.
I'd imagine that's where people go to die.
Well, it's either,
or
like,
be killed,
I think it's
and
also,
or elephant graveyard.
I think it's a burial plot, effectively. Like, they're at the point where they're burying the dead, they just throw them in the cave.
Yeah. Makes sense.
Elephant graveyard.
Effectively. Yeah, in a sense. And then the doctor's just like, you people. You people.
What do you mean?
And they're like, don't just lie there criticizing us. And he's like, whatever. And then I thought it was very interesting as they go through this, the sort of parallels that got built up between Cal and Zaz, like, struggle for leadership. Cal is saying, like, I brought the man who will make us fire. I should be leader. And Zaz's like, you don't have fire yet. Why would you be leader? You didn't even bring us fire. You brought us a man in strange furs. at the same time, Ian and the Doctor are sort of battling it out for who's in charge of this, like,
ill-thought-out rescue mission.
Yeah, well, now it's a prison break. Because they're stuck, and who should be leading them? Ian's the youngest and the strongest, as the Doctor points out, so he should be up front. We're going to skip over all the ignoring the women in this conversation entirely.
It's the 60s.
Yeah, for anybody who thinks that there are poor choice of feminist morals in today's Who, don't delve into classic.
Well, they are, but it's the 60s.
Yeah.
People didn't.
Which is
we're not going to
really
get started on that train.
Yeah. Before, you know, it's interesting because the producer of the show was a woman.
Yes.
And that was a big part. And even though we look back on it and go, oh, it's the 60s, the show itself and the production crew behind it were very progressive for the time.
Oh, yeah. It was an Indian director, the mm-hmm. first female producer ever at the BBC, probably on all British television. I don't know when it would align with American television. But a big milestone, her producing it. But you still have...
So we've gone backwards.
But you still have the, like, the woman being
the
60s, sold off.
Yeah.
Like, Horg sells off her.
Yeah.
Her.
She didn't even have a name.
No, she
that
had
might
a name.
Be her name. Her
was
name
it
is her.
Her name was Her, H-U-R, if you check the credits.
The credits where the camera stayed focused on one person's face and they had to keep looking that way at the camera.
Yeah, it was the old woman who didn't have a name. She was just old woman.
Yeah. She's killed your old woman. But so the old woman does break them out because she's that scared of fire. She's like, no fire. Get out of here. Even though, like, fire could probably keep them alive through, like, the impending ice age that's coming down the pipe. But then I thought it was interesting. So they're running through the woods at this point, like, trying to get out. Like, Ian
more like running in place
and
as, like,
in the face of branches.
Yes.
So for those of us who missed the running from New Who, this is the origin. This is what it's like the driving scenes in Manos' Hands of Fate.
Basically.
Just keep going.
Walk. But so, I thought it was, there's some great quotes in here, just like about the Doctor, as we're getting to see this, like, this dynamic struggle between the two of them. Like, you treat everybody and everything as something less important than yourself.
So we haven't changed.
But that's, I mean, that is something that stays somewhat true through to modern Who, of like, more or less, like sometimes the Doctor sees his companions as more important or humanity as more important than himself. But he is still a somewhat self-centered being.
He thinks of himself, well, he is very clever, but he knows he's very clever.
And that's the problem.
Exactly. And we've seen him talk, you know, in more modern Who about how he is important. But he also it's something that he learns later in life, I think, is that other people are important too.
Yeah, and that's... because he doesn't really care about humanity at this point. He is just dealing with... his own problems. He's lost. He's trying to get home.
Yeah, he just wants to go home.
And so he doesn't want it. He's like, why are we staying here? Why do you care about these people? His granddaughter sort of showing him the light of why humanity is interesting, why they're important. But he doesn't see it yet. So that's sort of like, going back, it's almost like in a prequel sense, seeing his journey to becoming this person that cares.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Backstory.
Yes.
I love
exactly. And so we get into like as like the fourth piece called The Fire Maker, and we'll just talk about it all. The lines are kind of blurred.
Because they get captured again.
They get captured again and brought back. They don't make it to the TARDIS.
Don't they get like really close?
They get close, but then was it Zaw? I almost called him Zod, but that's not right.
Zaw and her track them down in the woods,
mm-hmm.
and they are like, because they want to stop them. They're like, you escaped, like the old woman set you free, we've got to stop you. But then when Zah is attacked by, I guess, a bear, they establish there are bears
in the
neighborhood.
There are bear jokes here, I can't think of one.
Part of me thought like, oh, it's gonna be an alien, but that's how modern Who would do it.
I was thinking large cat.
Or dinosaur.
Puma. It did almost,
puma, yeah.
It did almost sound like it could have been like a saber-toothed tiger or something.
That would have been cool.
Wherever it was, they couldn't afford to show us.
They sure did have a papier-mâché boar skull, though.
Yeah. Which dead big. Barbara was very upset by. It's like a dead boar. Like, did nobody turn to be like, haven't you eaten bacon? Like a nice British slab of bacon in the morning. It's a boar. It's a
not pig. With a face.
Yeah,
face bacon.
To be fair, when you live in a British city, you know, how often are you going to see any dead animal? Well, dead farm animals, I guess.
Right.
But like she was, she was screaming as if it was a dead person.
Well, but they'd been kidnapped, and she's back in time, and it's not odd. For someone who was a school teacher 2 hours ago and is suddenly back in time, kidnapped by cavemen, running for their lives with strangers she doesn't know, with this guy who's not helping, and then there's a dead thing in front of her, that's the straw that broke the camel's back.
And I guess she's thinking, what killed it?
That too.
Is it near?
That yeah. too.
Although screaming is not going to help in that case.
Knee-jerk reaction.
But so Zaw gets attacked, and he's got he's very bloody, but they...
Which, thank God, those are only superficial.
I know, right?
Nothing serious.
But the doctor, this is the first time that he turns to the doctor and is like, help him. It's like, I'm not a medical doctor.
Got my my doctorate in philosophy.
Probably that's what it's...
You got a PhD in dance.
It's useful.
You missed the reference.
But so they cure him. They get like some water and they're washing his wounds, basically helping him live. Because if they just left him, he would have just died.
Exactly.
I mean,
because
I don't know
her
how,
was not helpful.
They didn't do much in the first place anyway. But like, I guess cleaning his wounds enough to help.
Yeah, and when they had an opportunity to run too, they stopped to help this guy. You know, that probably cost them an early trip, you know, back to the TARDIS and everything.
Considering they built a stretcher to carry him back, yeah. I'm going to go with you.
Yeah, they have the, like, carrying him back. But then the tribe, and even Zaw, like, turns on them.
Like I said, they would flip-flop like none other. It was super annoying.
But I feel like that's actually, it's almost realistic. Like, yes, Zaw's thankful that they helped. Like, he's going to bring them meat. Like, there's nowhere to go over the mountains, like wherever your tribe
that
is.
That was kind of cute. He was like, here, it's good, right?
It's like, they're I brought like, you meat, and they're cooking it. I like that with cavemen at one point, you're like, when the fire goes with the meat, it is great. Like, it's like, they're like, when we cook it, it's a good thing.
Well, and then they built a fire.
Yeah, I mean,
kind of a big deal.
With like sticks, like you're like, not supposed to. Although the fire you can see is like, I love he's like rubbing, he's supposed to be like rubbing the stick and he's just not even touching the other stick.
I was noticing that. I was like, how did he do
it's,
that?
The twinge. Magic. It's like you put the string between it and you use the string to rotate the center stick and it creates the friction that makes the fire. Booyah.
You really think Boy a British Scouts. School teacher knows that in the 60s?
Boy Scouts.
No, I mean, but no. But I didn't see a string. All I saw was like, because you rub the stick against the stick. That's like the classic way I was taught. But the stick was just like, it was like if you had the stick here, and then the other stick was like
yeah,
6 inches off to the right. It was just not even touching it.
And he just magically fire.
Just wait until the matches that are in there catch, and then move the sticks. Okay?
Or
okay.
They have like a little Bunsen burner underneath there. Oh. Either way, they get the fire going, and then Susan comes up with the idea, like, to put heads on, like, skull, like...
To put the skull on the torch so that, like, the fire was coming out of, like, the eyes and the mouth and everything like that, and the nose.
Which was great!
Yeah.
Yeah, and so that's the only way out. It's
so
just,
clever.
Evidently,
so
there's
clever.
Been a back door this entire time, and all we had to do was terrify the cavemen enough to distract them and for us to
well,
slip
and
out.
They didn't even go
while
out the
they
back
think
door.
We're randomly dead.
Yeah, they didn't even go out the back door that the old woman came in from. And when she sprung them,
really?
Yeah, everybody came in from the front
and they
started screaming because there were four skulls in the fire and they just nonchalantly like shuffled
Saunter out. They think we're dead. Bye!
Which, why would you rest your plan on the off chance that literally every single person is going to run into that cave?
Because every single person is dumb enough to run in that cave when other people start screaming. They're cavemen.
Yeah.
But
even back then, we had rubberneckers.
It's not the freeway; it's the fire.
And so during this whole thing, I skipped over it for a minute, but like I thought it was very interesting. The doctor kind of drops like an idea. I think it was the doctor dropped the idea into Zsa's head about the tribe can be stronger than one man. Was that the doctor or Ian?
I think it was Ian, because Ian was the one taking more of that mentorship role with him. I might be remembering that wrong.
You can yell at us later.
It just reminded me of like Rise of the Planet of the Apes, like with the stick metaphor. You break one stick, but a bundle of sticks is hard to break. That sort of thing.
Well, he's part of the idea of the tribe can be stronger than one man, altogether, like together, like. The fire maker becomes an unimportant person, not the leader, when everyone knows how to make fire. Teach everyone and then just be the strong leader, which is really like the fire is sort of a parallel to the TARDIS, like to time and space travel technology in this case. It's like once everybody understands it, the whole unit will be stronger. The doctor and now his three companions will all be a stronger group with four people who understand instead of just this one guy who knows everything.
Well, we've already seen what happens when the only person who knows how to make fire up and dies.
Yep. Right.
Then everyone else is hosed.
And you're left out in the cold.
literally.
So they run back and they're like, get them! throwing spears at them.
We want to take them alive. Spear.
Yeah, thank you for saving us. He gives some heat. You're running away. No, kill them. I think Zsa's almost like he's almost helping them in a way. Like it's his way of helping. They think they're going to get over the mountain. He's like, you're not going to make it. There's nothing over there.
We'll kill you before you go. That's helpful.
Well, but in a sense, I think the doctor later on, modern, he does that sometimes. Like if somebody's going to hurt themselves by doing what they want to, he'll try to stop them and keep them from doing that because why let them hurt themselves?
That's true.
So they'll learn. You think I'm kidding.
But it's a very, like, smart, it's a very wise thing to do. And to Zsa, he doesn't know any better.
No, and that's the thing, is that it's a decision born of ignorance. It might be good intentioned and a little bit selfish, too, because he needs them to, you know, help make fire and everything like that.
Which is just like Ian and Barbara's whole, like, decision process throughout this entire thing, not understanding really what's going on with the TARDIS.
But thinking they know what's best for Susan.
Yes. It's
that is an interesting parallel.
Born of ignorance. And that's why I was almost surprised, like just because of what I've heard conjecture through people about Classic Who, how actually intelligent this episode was. It was very well written, very well thought out. The subtleties are there. They didn't need to be huge. It's still cavemen kidnapping the doctor and his friends. But they're there for the adults watching, which just stresses like how much Doctor Who is a family show. The whole family can watch this and enjoy it.
They'd sit down at tea time and watch it. That's when you watch Doctor Who, is during your afternoon tea.
What time is that?
like 3 p.m.-ish?
So, yeah, okay, so it's the same time that we go for coffee because we're fading from existence.
Why do you think afternoon tea exists?
So this is where they get to the TARDIS. They're like run away. The spears just like fade through the TARDIS as it phases out. And they fly away. And this is where they really establish that they can't even get back to 1963. It's broken.
Yeah.
And like they're just gonna land where they land, and so they land on a planet called Scarrow.
Dun dun dun!
Cliffhanger.
Which for anybody who is obviously a fan of current Who and everything like that, that's a big red flag. It's like,
No.
You
no,
stay
no.
in the TARDIS and you turn that right back around.
Well, as they go out at the end of this to the big cliffhanger, because obviously nobody knows what Scarrow is at this point, is that the radiation, which had been teased before when there was obviously no radiation back in 100,000 BC or whatever we're dealing with, the radiation, they're like, they check it, which, like, not a very good detector if it's like you check it and then it changes to a minute later.
It's broken. Everything's broken.
But it clearly works enough to raise really quickly into
to let the audience know that this is dangerous, but not our heroes.
Yeah, so that they're out in the world of, like, as we know, the Daleks. And this is where the Doctor will meet the Daleks, which, tune in next week, guys, because we will be doing the first Dalek story.
Do you think there'll be a flight of stairs?
Somehow.
That is why that episode in 9 scared the daylights out of so many classic fans. Elevate was not a thing in the 60s.
So, I don't think they're going to have stairs. They'd have to install them in the studio because it was all shot. All of these first episodes were shot on stage. They never ventured out. That's part of why they're walking instead of running. Yeah. They don't have a lot of room.
Or running in place as, like, little branches hit them in the face.
That was so great.
And why the junkyard almost feels like you're inside a house that's, like, a hoarder's place or something. These people are now journeying through time and space trying to get home.
Now, here's a question, because we know, obviously, that the next episode involves the Daleks. Does the Doctor at this point know what the Daleks are, or is this the first encounter? Like, he's never even heard of them prior to this.
I don't think so. I mean, I'm
commenters, don't say anything. Seriously, don't say anything. Not about this.
Okay.
She doesn't like spoilers. Yeah.
AfterBuzz commenters are very, very good at not saying spoilery things if we ask them not to say spoilery things.
All right, well...
They are.
We're going to wrap up real quick here, guys. But I just think of... Last thoughts on this. I think that it's very similar to... or reminds me of recently, Capaldi. He was like, then I... In Into the Dalek, which we just saw last week. Then I went to Scar... I didn't know who I was. I was the Doctor, but I didn't know who I was. Then I went to Scarrow. Mm. And I knew that I was not the Daleks. He's defined himself today by not being the Daleks. Hmm. And so next week, tune in. What next? Same time next Wednesday at 7, or whenever you're choosing to listen and watch. To Doctor Who Classics, we're going to be doing the second storyline, the next 4 episodes of Doctor Who, which you can also see on Hulu Plus. The death of the Daleks, I believe it is, or the Dalek of Death. I'm sorry. You're gonna yell at me. I know you guys are all gonna yell at me.
Same Doctor time, same Doctor channel, because there are no bats yet.
So guys, thank you so much for tuning in to the first first episode here of Classic Who. Megan, where can the people find you if they want to keep up with you?
You can find me on Twitter at TheManguin. That's TAGMENGUIN. I am also on the Attack on Titan, Sword Art Online, and Ruby panels here at AfterBuzz.
You can catch me on Twitter at TauriJ. That's TauriJay. You can also catch me on the Extant panel and the Sword Art Online panel on Sundays.
I'm Katie Cullen. You can find me on Twitter and Tumblr at Kiaxet. That's KIAXET. I'm also on the Attack on Titan, Sword Art Online, and upcoming Z Nation panels on Sundays and the Ruby panel every other Thursday.
Booyah.
And you guys catch me on Twitter and Instagram at ThatZachWilson, TheZachWilson. And also here at AfterBuzz, you can catch me occasionally on, as well as some of the other people here, on regular Doctor Who, on The Leftovers, which we'll be wrapping up, The Strain, a bunch of new shows coming up this fall, including Z Nation, Grace Point, if you're a David Tennant fan. and of course, here next week for the classic Doctor Who episode, The Daleks, The Dead Planet, which is why I'm
it's a little early for them all to be dead.
Thanks for tuning in, guys. I'm Zach Wilson, and thanks for geeking out with us.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here. And be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.